as an individual. All right, so you go back before the beginning, which is creation, and you find the beginning, which is the Father's view of His Son, which is not called the Son, but it's called Logos. That's the beginning. Okay, then the next stage is, okay, that was good. That was before anything else was, and if nothing ever came into existence, if there was no creation, that would always stand. That's why this is the beginning and the end, the Alpha and the Omega, and He's everything in between. Okay? So that is. But God has a pattern that He wants to bring forth. And so this reality, this beginning, means absolutely nothing if we who are down here in this realm can't become a partaker or not even aware that it's there. Okay, so there must be a revelation of it to somebody. Now, I'm using this as a pattern, not just for how this thing started, but as a pattern of how it will always start. Somebody, somewhere, needs to see the truth. And when they see the truth, they will be the next step as this thing begins to flow. Okay? So an individual begins to have this unveiled. The word revelation means unveiling. Begins to have this unveiled. An unveiling isn't a creating. A revealing isn't bringing something into existence. A revealing is simply unveiling that which is always there. So this person, doesn't matter who he is, and that's another important point, is it does not matter who the person is who begins to come to a revelation. Somebody has to see them, because that's the next step. So let me read. Someone must see past the letters on the pages of the scriptures into the very face of Jesus, where shines the light of the knowledge of the glory of God. That's 2 Corinthians 4:6. All right? Once they have seen past just the scriptures into the face of Jesus, then they begin to be captivated. I said, having seen the light that is the light of men, he must declare that others may receive light. This is taken from, and I'm doing the progression. I started with John 1:1, then I went to John 1:4, now we're in verse 6 and 7. There was a man sent from God, whose name was John. The same came for a witness, to bear witness of the light that all men through him might believe. Okay? So he was one who was a witness. He had witnessed or seen the light. Anyone that you want to put it. So we use the terminology of revelation, the revelation of Christ. You can use anything. You know, we are the church of the see the light. You know what I mean? I see the light. You know what I mean? I mean, it's because this is the light that you see. I mean, it doesn't matter the terminology. But somebody must see the light. And in seeing the light, then you become a witness. You cannot declare or witness about what you have not witnessed. You know? I mean, a police drives up to your house and says, I'm going to talk to you about the robbery that happened over on, over on the square today. Well, I wasn't up on the square. But you wouldn't make a very good witness. You have to not only be on the square, but you have to see what went on before you can be a declarer or a witness. And see, we always use the term witness. Like, if you're not a witness, man, you're a witness. You're a declarer. But no, a witness is not first to declare. He is first a seer, or he is one who has seen something. And only then can he become a declarer. Okay? So, there was a man sent from God, his name is John. The same came for a witness, to bear witness of the light, that all men through him might believe. Alright, so his initial deal was he simply saw this. He may not have been thinking in terms of becoming a declarer, thinking in terms of body of Christ are gathered together, thinking in terms of spreading the message. World evangelization ultimately bringing Christ back, and I want this gospel to continue to preach in all the world. For a witness then shall come to him. He may have simply, from a true heart or a pure heart, been just asking the unknown God, if you will, to make himself known. It's the longing to know God. It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter what is, you know, if he wasn't trying to establish something great or do this or that. He just wanted to know God. God chose to an individual to get the revelation, to unveil himself. Okay. Now, once done, usually there's a kind of a process within that before he becomes a declarer. The first thing is, when you begin to see, you are, it's like another world, and you have to continue in my word. If you didn't say continue in my word, you should know the truth, not just glimpse it. And so you continue on this time of seeing and knowing, because this is where reckoning comes from. I mean, you can't reckon on something that, you know, reckoning means to add up. You know, you add, put all this stuff down, you add all it up, you come up to this conclusion. So you can't reckon yourself dead, you can't reckon on the finished work of Christ, you can't reckon on the blood of Jesus until you've added it up enough times to go, my God, this is the truth. You know? The Lord is truth of reckoning. You know, we have all these weird ideas of what reckoning is, but it's nothing more than seeing the truth over and over until you become convinced. And God, in his faithfulness, begins that process. So I believe there are probably many people who have begun the process of revelation, but I'm talking about not just somebody that's glimpsed a little bit. And I know people. God showed him some truth, and particularly, let's say, thinking of one particular person, that God showed him the truth of the cross, that he was dead. Christ was his life. That person never got the word hardly after that. Didn't see the Lord anymore. Felt like he had what was called the revelation of Christ. And that was it. And the guys, you know, I want to tell you all the best that you can say. God wants you to continue. God wants you to seek him. And as you do, a reckoning process, without you even understanding reckoning, this is one of the really cool things about all this, is it really does work. I think that we hinder it from working by trying to make it work. You know, if you just seek the Lord, knock everything else out, we're trying to fit in, say all the right terminology, you know, spout stuff before we really know it, and we just seek the Lord. That's all. Just be a real sincere, dumb person who loves God. You should probably know a whole lot better than a real smart person who's trying to do that. So if you don't even understand reckoning, you've never even heard, per se, the scriptures you've read, but you just keep searching the Word, and keep looking to the Lord, and he keeps showing you, and you see it, and see it, and see it, and see it, and you go, wow. Until one day, it'll tip the scales, and then you know, you've gone from believing to knowing. Or you know, some people say, now you know and you're knowing. Or you know that you know, or whatever. But the only thing I can tell you is that it's the truth. And if you have truly seen it as the truth, everything else seems just really ridiculous. That's all I can say. It just seems really ridiculous. And so you just kind of go, well, this is it then. You know, this is, you look at what you got and you go, I guess I need to put it towards this. It's what this was in the beginning before me. This wasn't contingent on me, and all I do, now I've seen it and realize I'm in it. I didn't put myself in it in that sense. I'm God, are you in Christ? So, you know, the plan of God is the thing that we put me in there. I mean, my little, in fact, most of our faith was nothing more than I see it, I've sinned, and I admit it, which is real virtuous, you know. It's like robbing a bank, and somebody walk up, you know, the police surrounds you as you're doing it, and you go, oh, yeah, I did it. You know, they're going to let you go. process of wrestling happens until you come to what I would say and say, I'm just making that bridge, take away all the arrows, and then you just say that you have the revelation to it. You have a person who has seen or believed, or, you know, I don't know how to put it, you know, I've used this simple term, mean nothing. You have a believer. Someone that sees the lot. Okay. So that is involved a period of time for this individual. And in his mind and his heart, I'm really like John the Baptist. Who knows what this guy went through? I mean, his father was a priest. His father before him was a priest. His father before him was a priest. If you're born in this family, you're a male, you're in the priesthood. And this guy has seen the light, and it's taking away the taste for religion and for, you know what I'm saying? It's just burned him in relationship to being a Pharisee and being in the priesthood and all this stuff. But he is in the priesthood. He is truly what God always had in mind. He's one that has seen the truth. I mean, he's everything God could have ever wanted for a priest. And, you know, his dad, when he was going to be born, his dad was scared to death when an angel appeared to him. You know, and he'd go, but you're a priest, aren't you supposed to, like, be in here communing with God and everything, you know? You know what I'm saying? And we're going, I can't believe it. Do you believe in that? Yeah. Do you believe there's God? Yeah. But this scares the hell out of me. think about this. Have you ever heard somebody's story when they said an angel appeared to them and they talked to the angel, like, da da da? Did you ever think in your mind, oh, an angel showed up to me, that ain't good, great. And they seem to be so nonchalant about it, yeah, the angel appeared and talked, da da da. Have you ever considered that maybe they actually just believed in it and the one showed up, they didn't freak them out as much as you would do to say you believed in it? You understand what I'm saying? So John, though, on the other hand, he didn't just see an angel. He didn't just have an appearance. This guy was a priest, and he saw him, and he came to bear witness of the life. My God, what a place. He saw the light. He saw the Lord. He saw the beginning. He saw the Father, and he saw the heart of the Father toward his Son called Logos. Good grief, you know? And so he grew in that, and he grew, but there was upheavals in that. You know, he's the guy that preached about, hey, when this one comes and he has come, he's going to make the mountains come down, and the crooked straight, and he's going to flood, you know what I mean? That's the way he described it. Where do you think he got all that from? I mean, when Jesus showed up, mountains and started falling, and the world's all straightened out, and you know, everybody lived on a corner block or something, you know? That didn't happen. What the heck was he talking about? I mean, what is this guy talking about? I'll tell you what he's talking about. He's talking about what happened in him and what's going to happen in you, Jack, when you're speaking in him. That's what he's talking about. He says, man, I mean, it's all the mountains falling in the sea, and you know, like, I was pulled and tied. But he's the one. This is the one. And so this is what happens to that individual, that gets in line, begins to fall in line with this flow, because the beginning means nothing. It can't touch the soil until somebody sinned. So John saw. Okay. Then having not just one time sin, once again, not revelation in the thought of big, a revelation of Christ. No such thing. Okay. We're talking about reckon, a revelation unto reckoning, which never ends, by the way. We still come to revelation and see things. Okay, but having reckoned and come to that steady place, so much so saw that you're willing to go against the whole religious system, all of your family and all that they expected for you and all the things they got and all the, you know what I mean? You talk about the curtain and all the mountains and all that stuff, you know? And you, but you counted the cost. I mean, this is it and this is it and this is it and I ain't no, you know. I mean, now that's, by the way, that's a real way of testing somebody's seen it. You know what I mean? I mean, you go through a lot to test the vision. You know, Joseph's thrown in prison. God shouts from heaven, there he is, my beloved son. Satan takes him for 40 days and puts him through temptations. You know what I mean? So, you know, if you got it, you got it. You know, if you don't, you'll be found out and you need to go back. And you get it. But once again, it's not just one time forever. But if it happens, then you've been through that period of testing, you've been through that pressure, you've been through all those things, and you can, in each case, there is nothing in the central, because really that's all gone. I'm talking two realms. I mean, there's nothing in this sense realm that can make this not be valid if you sin. There's nothing that can make that invalid. You can go through temptation, which would make you doubt in your soul, and if you go with your soul, then you've invalidated it at that moment in time. But you haven't invalidated the truth and stopped the reality of God. And, you know, the best thing to do is go, I was stupid. I went for a moment with my senses. I'm not anymore. You know, a new beginning isn't a new start. A second chance. Not a second chance. It is returning to the beginning. A new.
That's right.
You know, because that's from the beginning and the end and out and away. You know, understand what I mean? It's not, you know, this is my seventh new beginning this week. You better get together. You know, God didn't do it like that. You know what I mean? You messed up and I keep getting it in new beginnings and I'm getting a little tired of it. You know, this week, this is always. He ain't getting tired of it. It always is. And he's not here in a sense. He's not doing anything. All you're doing is by faith, leaving the senses, holding to what you've seen, and walking by that which is. That's all. I mean, you didn't do anything. You just, if you could put it like in another realm, it's like you walking back in and God's like, good dad, back. You know, and he just goes on, he demonstrates, and that's all he knows. You just start getting in. Does anybody get that? I mean, that realm is more like it. We're all, you know, I mean, you know, we want God to reach down and go, you know, well, when I feel like I'm not a new beginning, then most of the time you have to go, I don't go by these things. I don't go by all this stuff, because that's not a new beginning. It's not a new washing of my senses to feel spiritual. A new beginning is the beginning that I am in, that I have returned to by faith, and I walk boldly into it. Because it is, was, and what, and it was way before I came along, and couldn't rise at all with me. Which is healing. Great.
What I'm feeling right now, because he wasn't human body, he had to go through all the things. I'm sure
you know, he had to go through that. You know, it's the same thing with us. You know, we have to choose to believe what's there, what you did, and how it applies to us, and what's the price. So I don't see, you know, we can have, you know, just put a point on how so many people got freaked out over that portrayal of it in one sense. It was true. He was in that area.
Since this is the beginning of the body, not any study of John, when the Jews sent priests and Levites from Jerusalem to ask him, what did they come to ask him? Who art thou? Who art thou? And he confessed and denied not, but confessed, I am not. I love that. It is a declaration, not of what he is, but of what he is not. I love that. He's ready to declare that if you're going to ask him, who are you, then he doesn't say, I am, you know, this and to that. And he begins, and he eventually will say exactly what he feels he is. But he must first declare what he is not. This is it. I am not this. I am not the one. I'm not what it's all about. And if you hear this from me, that doesn't make me anything more than one that's seen it, just like you can see it and declare it. It has no bearing on the, you know, the delivery boy, the messenger boy. So he confessed and denied not, but confessed, I am not the Christ. And they asked him, well, what then? See how it goes? Well, what then? And they start throwing out stuff like that, Elias and Elijah, and he says, I'm not. Art thou that prophet? Because there was a prophet that was supposed to be John the Baptist, wasn't a prophet, but they're taking it from another angle. And he answered no. That's verse 19 and 21. So, I don't know, people become confused when someone doesn't claim to be something special. That throws them. I mean, I am a prophet of God. I have heard from the Lord. Oh, come to the prophet. Put your hand on the David. You know what I mean? Or something like that. You know? And receive from the prophet of God. You know? And you go, this is totally contrary to everything of truly the pattern, the order, and the way that it works. You do not declare yourself. You declare another. You declare what you see. And they will come and try to make you declare yourself. And if you get caught up in the reaction of people other than the reality that you have received, you'll be stuck in. You will be stuck in the pattern. But if you keep your eyes on him and never drop them to, well, who are you? Who are you? It's almost as if John's eyes were continually on Jesus. No, nope, I'm not him. No, I'm not this, I'm not that, no. Instead, you drop your eyes and you go, look at all these people here. Look, even the big shots came all the way from Jerusalem out here to the Jordan and they're checking me out. Hey, man, the press is next, you know. And as soon as Jesus got caught in the press, he goes, look at this one. You know, and we start going, oh, look at this. Instead of going, look at him. I know what I'm here for. I know what I've seen. I know what will never change. I know what has made me something, and it hasn't made me anything, really. I mean, he is still what I am. He is still the thing. That's why we call him the treasure and us the earthen vessel. We don't call us the glorious vessel, the jeweled vessel. We call him the treasure. We have this treasure in earthen vessels. That the excellency of the power may be of God, none of us. He said, none of us. He ain't trying to make us special in that sense. We already declared last class how special you are. But you are a unique expression of Christ. You become more special than the treasure. The servant is not greater than his Lord. When the servant becomes greater than his Lord, you know, then something happens. And let me tell you, in the Old Testament, or I guess anytime the son became greater than the father, or the ones that the king taught, the other rulers, became wiser than the ruler, you know what they did? They killed him. Yeah, they killed the guy that's above. It's not. It's a normal reaction. I know more than you, so you're out of here. It's a normal reaction. You know? So they had this little thing that said, children respect your parents and stuff like that. Respect your elders. You know what I mean? I mean, there's some wisdom in that. Because, you know, be not wise in thine own eyes to fear the Lord. You know? Be not wise in thine own eyes. And if you realize that my wisdom is Christ, I come to hear all wisdom, the treasures of wisdom and knowledge, says this in Colossians, the treasures of wisdom and knowledge are in Christ. What is that? And so when you realize they're not in you, and that as you are plugged in as one who has revelation, you're like a glorified funnel. You see this, you disseminate it out, all you're doing is declaring that which you're just a channel for that. Now I realize once again that there is conformity to the image and all that, but we're not talking about that right now. And I can't preach every sermon I've ever taught to cover every time I ever, so I have to stick with just a few things. So people become confused when someone doesn't claim to be something special. In this age of super ministries and super egos, it's refreshing to find someone who is the Lord as He is revealed in the Word first. Even so, some still want to know who that person thinks he is. Who do you think you are? Who do you think you are? Who do you think you are? Then said they unto him, Who art thou? That we may give an answer to them that sent us. What sayest thou of thyself? So when they finally named him down, because he says, I'm not. No, I'm not. I'm not. I'm not. You want my declaration to be? I'm not. I'm not. I'm not. I'm not. He is, of course, but you're talking about, I'm not. I'm not. So they finally pinned him down and says, Who art thou? We want to give an answer. What sayest thou of thyself? So finally he said, I am the voice of the Lord. I'm not the one. I'm the voice of the Lord. I'm the voice of the Lord. I'm not the voice of a whole lot of servants. I'm not the voice of a whole lot of subjects. I'm not the voice of a whole lot of theological platform. I'm not the voice of, I am the voice of the Lord. I speak with one. I declare one. I've come to declare. I've come to bear witness of the light. I've seen that which is from the beginning. And the disciple John is the one who said, that which is from the beginning, we have declared unto you. That's what he said. That's what we have declared unto you. That which is from the beginning. So John the Baptist, in like manner, says, I am the voice of God. You want to know what I am? You want to know what I say of myself? Oh, because that's what you see. They were really trying to really get it. Well, what sayest thou of thyself? And, you know, that can start self-examination, which can look at you in light of you instead of in light of you as in relationship with Him. Once you do that, well, I guess I'm one of the few that's really seen this, and therefore I'm really special. See what I mean? You're opening yourself a job. You can't see yourself in a temporal relationship. And if you see it in that eternal relationship, that's it. This is it. This is what it's all about. And I'm just coming to you right now. You know? What sayest thou of myself? I'm a voice. I'm just a voice. And this is what he did this way. I am a declarer. And at this stage, that's all that's necessary. Okay, let's see if I can finish this. He claims that he's just a declarer of the one that he has seen in the world. The one is the Word, the Logos. Clean thought is not accepted by God. And now let's get real. Okay, if Jesus, let's do it like this. If Jesus is the Logos, the complete thought and concept of God, how are you going to be anything out of it? He is the complete thought and concept of the Father. He is the fullness of all that the Father has wanted from the beginning, before there was. What are you going to declare yourself to be? Well, I'm one of the hot shots over here on the edge. You know what I mean? Hey, at best, if he truly is the Logos to the Father, then at best, all you are is the voice of the one who is. See what I'm saying? I mean, how could you ever? You could not be. If the truth has you, you cannot go astray. You can't. Everybody knows better. What I mean is the more the truth has you, about beware of the flatterer, the one that comes in. And one of the attributes of the Antichrist, by the way, with which you will be able to persuade and move men, is this tremendous ability to flatter. Well, you're so good. I tell you, there's nothing can really share this stuff. So the force of one, there's nothing can share this stuff like you. That would make you barf. You know what I mean? If you're the voice of one, and they said nobody can share this stuff like you, you're going, excuse me, I'm busy. You don't even want to hear that. That is an offense to you because it is breaking. It is going against everything. And you see, that's why it's called Antichrist. Is he not? He's against this. And if you're pro Christ, how's he going to get you? Make you pro you. Flattery will make you pro you. He don't have to make you pro Satan. You know what I'm saying? He don't have to make you pro this or that. Other things outside of this. If you're pro Christ, for Christ, you're a declarer of Christ, then all he's going to do is make you pro you. Look what you did. Look what you've seen. Look how far you've come. Aren't you special? There's not a whole lot of people in the world that have really seen what you've seen. Or there's not a whole lot of churches that have done it. I don't know. I don't even know all the drivers you can say because I don't listen to them. I'm even having to try to figure out. Listen, I have heard, and there have been people that, you know, there's, see, I can tell the difference between a sincere person who comes and visits or something, and they hear the word, maybe for the first time, and their hearts are driven to us, and they come up afterwards, and they don't know how to say it. And they just go, you know, they've been touched by the war and the message of Christ, and they truly, their spirit, maybe, you know, it's really, really been touched. And all they know to say is, I've never heard anybody preach like you. I know what that means. I know exactly. They're not talking about me, and they ain't talking about, whoa, no, I've never heard nobody declare like you. They're not, that's not what's in their heart. What's in their heart is, whoa, the Lord. I know, because I remember when I first came. I know. Whoa. You know, but when you don't have all the terminology, you haven't separated man from, you know, an institute, you go, whoa, you know, and you just go, well, thank you very much. I mean, there was a time I used to go, oh, Anna, don't get me any, Lord. You know, and I'd have to make this big deal because I was afraid that, and then I began to discern the hearts of men. I began to realize, but on the other hand, if somebody comes up and they are a flatterer, and I've heard flatterer, they'll come up and they'll go, ooh, and touch you, pat you on the shoulder. It's like a wife, you know, slam on your head. And you talk, it's like, oh, it's just, and you just go, you know, Christ in you doesn't, he's a lamb. The Spirit of God is a dove. If he moves in a way that you take up before you drive the money changes out, that's fine. That's also been found in John. But usually I just want to get away. And usually a flatterer, you know, a flatterer gets his way most of the time. I mean, because flesh is flesh. It's religious flesh or business flesh or, you know what I mean? I mean, it doesn't matter what your deal is. If you're flesh, you're open to it. And so if it's religious flesh, he'll get his way, and he knows if the hooks are being put in, and he sees the responses, or senses the responses of sheep, and knows what's going on. And they also can tell if they're not getting through. They can tell that they're not getting through, and a fighter will not hang around very often. Just like a tailbearer, where there is no wood, the fire goes out. That's what it says, the tailbearer and the prophet. If you don't feed fuel into their little thing, it won't burn. You know? And the flatterer is the same way. If your response is, you know, totally nothing, you're not feeding anything, and you're not responding in any, you know, we give off these vibes and stuff, you know, people can tell. Oh, well, thanks a lot, you know. I was feeling really down, and you came along just at the right time to pump my flesh up. How many of you have ever felt really down? Somebody's come home just at the right time to come to the pleasure of pleasure. Well, there's a few of us. told me Sunday night, I said, man, you don't know. You preach and you dealt with stuff that just happened and da-da-da-da and all this stuff. And they said, it's just like you knew everything. And I said, what happened? And I didn't know nothing. I didn't know nothing. But you know, it's so funny because people, I mean, you know, I've had people accuse me of bugging their car on the way to church. My God, what kind of blue is there? I swear I don't even know this. And I get accused of lots. I just want to make it clear to you that I'm just truly trying to listen to the Lord. I know that I've talked with people who have hours or just the day before the night before, and I'll stand up and I'll share things and say things that sound very similar to what I shared, and I'm never directing that flesh that you'll never, first of all, you'll never accomplish anything directing by regard to the flesh, okay? You can't change flesh by, you know, fiery dart affecting. The best way to do it is to preach Christ, and if the Holy Spirit bears witness, then trust that I'm not working over. I'm saying this because I feel something in my spirit to warn you, reminding you that I don't know everything, I don't see everything, I just simply try to preach when I hear it, say this, at this point, say that, and I try to do it. So, if you're ever getting down because Randy doesn't like me anymore, because he preached that little part that we had discussed or something like that, and I didn't get down because I brought him out of the way. It's the only one I've left. Okay, I guess we need to stop. So, I promised you that this time, and I lied, okay, so forgive me. So the next time, we're going to get into the finishing touches of this, but I think we'll be pointed all the time to take the legs off. We're going to read a few more sentences for the men. He claims that he is just a declarer of the one that he has seen before. He is just a voice, and this is what I like. He is just a voice of a singular message. The voice of one. Of a singular message. Isn't that cool? The voice of one. And the way the Holy Spirit translates a singular message. And so every day, day is coming up. Every day he has but one motivation. It's not all confused. It's not all, what do I do? He's got one motivation. But this action of lifting up Jesus, this is where we're going to be next time. This is the last step, but it is the bridge towards that. But this action of lifting up Jesus will soon begin to draw all men. Father, we thank you for this time. Thank you for hungry hearts and those that are sensitive to your spirit that is here, desiring to teach and guide us into all truth. Lord, may every one of us in this place hear from your spirit. Father, any areas, if I got off on anything, if there's anything that wasn't in you, somehow void it out. Let that not be remembered anymore, but only that which is of your spirit. Spirit-breathed, Christ-centered, grow.